Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. This is the WiX Online Meeting 156. We're into October. I think the next time we'll be talking about Halloween kind of meetings, or will it be November? I don't know. Anyway, we'll talk about that at the end. What are we doing today? Mostly just triage. We missed a week, or not a week, we missed 2 weeks, which makes it 4 weeks, so we have a few more bugs than typical to kind of walk our way through, and then we'll cover anything else that other people want to talk about here and now. I don't have a lot of otherwise updates. September was a very busy month for me. All right, so let's go get to it. Bob, you ready?
Ready.
All right. As I mentioned, September was really busy for me, and these are things I want to get to, but they're just a little lower priority than where I'm at right now. And then I want to go back on all the Wix 4 code review comments. Thank you, Sean, for doing the work to hook it all up to a issue, and I'll go back through all of that stuff and address them. So I think we can scroll past these bottom three for a review later and start with the remaining eight. We'll do that. Cool. All right. Harvest item group in the project only works on rebuild or clean build. That's entirely possible. That is entirely possible that it will not recognize when new files are added or removed. Uh-oh. Outlook is Mark Outlook IE is stuck. Oh, just the scroll. My mouse wheel stopped working there. All right. Anyway. So, yep. And this guy suggests that he has to change the file dates on it. Yeah. No. This is a thing. We have our own harvesting thing that we developed at FireGiant and had a very similar bug to this that was kind of like it. But this is heat, so someone that wants to go work on heat could go work on this. So I guess this can go 4x, and someone could try to fix it if they wanted. Right?
Yeah, that works for me.
Yeah. I don't work on heat, so someone else that does want to can. Unable to install Wix extension to latest Visual Studio release. So this was interesting. I already commented at the bottom of this saying, yeah, when V6 has failed to install, you have to go to to go to Visual Studio team because they control the installer. What I just had this thought when I was reviewing this bug before, they have to be a local admin with no access to internet. I think this is the behavior that when you install one V6, it tries to update all of Visual Studio. It's a very interesting behavior choice that they made. And so
yes.
I think that our install is bringing along, well, Visual Studio has decided they're going to update a bunch of things and they try to update Wix, and then it tries to bring down a whole bunch of other stuff in the internet, which then creates problems. So either way, they should take this to the Visual Studio team and have them look at why that's failing. Didn't help that I think it was in German. Yeah.
It doesn't help me.
Yeah. But anyway, so I think this is external. Wix V4 throws odd error when using the equals operator. The equivalency operator. Sorry, not equals. Found valid expression in invalid sub-expression. Oh. Well, that sounds busted. Yeah, this should go in 4.0.
Yeah, well, the problem is there isn't actually an equal-equal operator.
Oh.
That's the root of the problem. The root of the problem is, of course, yeah, Wix uses an MSI-like, aka ZB-like syntax, and there isn't an equal-equal. It's just equal sign, which is wrong. I mean, array indices start at zero and equality is equal equal. That's just the way of the world. Unfortunately,
that error is bad.
It's a bad error given, you know.
A very simple mistake. And one
yes,
would argue that we could allow that as a valid equivalency operator as well. I don't know if that would break anything.
Well, based on this experience, I don't think so. But this was in Wix 4, so I don't know exactly what Wix 3
does. Well, all right, so let's back up a second. In Wix 4, should we allow the double equals in an if statement? I mean, we're definitely...
Well, my only concern there is, you know, we could do double equals. Do we then want to do, you know, bang equals?
Instead of the not.
Yeah.
In And then you could do not
actually
something bang equals this, which then
wait, what do we do? Do we actually force people to do greater than less than? Or sorry, less than greater than?
Okay, no opinions from Sean. Sean's like, I'm not touching this one.
Oh. Well, okay, that's officially odd. Bang equal is the not equal operator.
Yeah.
According to the doc.
Do you enforce the change or make sure an optional? I'm inclined to support both equals and both equals and double equals as equivalency in if statements. I mean, and just be like, yeah, we don't care. Because I mean, we're definitely not doing assignment in if statements, right? That's, I mean, I don't know why C allowed that. It's just like, that just creates too much pain. So equals, I don't quite follow. Why so many equals in that one, Jacob?
And technically, that should be equal.
I think he's trying to say double equals equals single equals.
Oh. Well played, Jacob. And well found, Sean. Yes. All right. Yes, we're adding double equals. I don't see any reason why not to. And it's.
Yeah, and given that we support bang equals, yeah, I think we should absolutely support it. I don't see where it would, even if somewhere it might change behavior, it's not going to break anybody.
Yeah, and then we could add triple equals like JavaScript, too.
Oh, sure. Let's do that.
No, sorry. No, they're just wrong. But rather, they did the same. They had to do the same thing where they ended up with reference equals and equivalency or whatever. I think that. I don't know. I mean, in the preprocessor.
Probably WixCop should translate it.
I don't know that. Basically, I'm down to, I don't really care which one you use.
And if it can be done unambiguously, I don't see why we can't support both.
Yeah, I mean, equals will never be part of an identifier, and we're never going to get confused on that front, right? So it's clear what it is.
That's always going to be in an if instruction,
right? Because we don't have
any
loops. I mean, our loops don't work like that.
Yeah. We have them, sadly, and they don't work like this.
Yes. Before. Over. I'm inclined to just go, yeah, whichever one you want to use. And if we really wanted, someone could add a rule to say WixCup has a preference. WixCup has lots of preferences, so I'd be fine if it had a preference. Well, clearly not that, Jacob. It's equals or double equals. It's an operator, right? It's a token. We'll parse it as a token, and those two tokens, equals and double equals, are equivalent tokens in an if statement. And 5, 6, 7, I can't tell how many equals there are in that. 6, 7, 7, 8. Good grief, there's so many equals in that, is not a token that's recognizable. And I don't really know what I would say if someone walked up, if a JavaScript programmer walked up and said, I want 3. It might hurt my head a little bit.
I'm fine with no.
Yeah, no. I think we could take that.
And this is easier than fixing the message, I think.
Yeah, although the message might be might show up in an invalid sub expression, this expression, that. Wow, that's brutal. So, all right, let's do that for this one. Okay, let's see. WiX 4 malform preprocessor instruction crashes. I think I fixed this one. No, you did. All right, Bob fixed this one.
It was fixed.
It was. I don't know who fixed it. It must have been you, because it's your face on it, right? All right, cool.
Sure.
This is fixed. So Yay, let's put it in four and put it in. Do we have a preprocessor label? I don't remember. Probably do, given how many labels we have.
No, we don't.
All right, then. Oh, we're gonna have problems in the future if we keep tagging things candle. Dun dun dun.
Now we do.
All right. Exceptions are reported coming from Wix targets. Yeah, this is when we're crashing, we're not spitting out good error messages in the end, especially this one. An item has been added to this. Item with
Well,
the
which
same key has already been added. That's bad.
starts as a bad error message anyway. Thank you, framework.
Yeah, all right. Yeah, this needs to be fixed. Let's put it in four. We need to fix that.
It's a problem. At that point,
Yeah, we've had them in the past. We need to make that's a really bad error message. We have to do better than that. If anything, it has to be the what is the internal consistency error, whatever. No, that's ICE's. Internal compiler error. That's it. It's like you have to get
Oh,
at
yes.
least that, and then double hold them because clearly the compiler is upset with itself. We'll go for that. And this is we could not find entry section. Yes, the whole new intermediate post link. Yeah, let's put this at four. I don't want to discuss it. We should discuss this one now. So in the past we had a little way to get a little way. You could get out of the Wix toolset a Wix out, which was an XML representation of the MSI after being linked but before being bound. And you could do funky things with it. You could use it in various places, but it wasn't ever really locked down, and you really had to kind of know what you're doing. So in Wix 4, we're trying to make it a bit more of a normal place to get, essentially, since we have separate binders, and the linker is a standard. Preprocessor compiling and linking is very standard for the Wix toolset, straightforward line. And then binding, you have all different kinds of things you do, bundles versus MSIs, merge modules, patches, all that kind of stuff. So the idea of being able to stop after linking and making that a real thing is what we call an intermediate file post link. It's not a great name. If anybody came up with a better name, love it. Wix out wasn't a great name before because technically speaking, you get Wix outs at different places and they were different. It was not great. So we now have this thing called intermediate post link. The problem is that when you say you want output type of intermediate post link, aka don't bind, we give you this error message that I can't scroll to for some reason that says, oh, no, it's like a picture. I don't know, whatever. It's probably them telling me that IE doesn't work. It says basically, hey, we could not find an entry section in intermediate post link. So it couldn't find out, it didn't know if you were building an MSI or a bundle, so it can't say, hey, couldn't find an entry section for a bundle of post link. And so we need to do better here. And when Bob pointed this out to me, I was like, we should just make this error message better. So I don't know that we need to make this error message better here, but I do think we should go think about how to make this error message better. Because this is the first very real place that a user could get exposed to the concept of section, and on top of that, oh, an intermediate, and on top of that, the concept of an entry section. So, like, there's a whole lot of brand new concepts that they would never have thought of if they were just using the Wix toolset and never hitting an error at link time, essentially. This is a link time failure, and we're exposing some internals of the compiler that either maybe we shouldn't expose, or we need to do a better job explaining what they are. So I think spending some time on this error message is a good thing because it's not that hard to get into it. Essentially, you forget to add your product or your module or your bundle element to, the top.
Well, but this is kind of the problem. I agree the error message could be better in general. But we have, there's a fork in the road. It's like when you have an output type of intermediate post link, you don't know what the expected output type actually was. In a way, IPL as an output type is it makes sense from an implementation perspective, but we're kind of like abusing the concept of output type, which in the other fork in the road here is output type adds some clarity to the or could add some clarity to the message. Like for example, if we knew that the output type was package, then the error message could be explicit and say I couldn't find a product element or
I agree and it but intermediate post like foreshadows an advanced scenario. It's not a normal, like you don't get into it simply. So I think
right.
if the answer in intermediate post link was could not find a product or bundle or module or for example
yeah.
a product
yeah.
people would be like, oh yeah, I knew enough to know that I was building a product. Right. And then for other people they hit it, anyway, I do think this error message could use, a full-on three-sentence kind of.
Sure. Sorry, I was just suggesting that it's not a single error message. The best solution is probably to break it up.
I'm not against that either.
Okay.
We have plenty of messages, error messages that have different forms when they have more inputs.
Yeah, exactly.
So, all right, so let's put this in four. Yep.
How does the code know which one it's looking for? Or is it just looking for any of them?
How does it know which entry section it's looking for?
Yeah.
It's looking for any entry section. This is the case where it didn't find
this
any.
Code is...
There's another error message that we probably should put in this too. It's a good idea that if it has multiple, you can't do that either because the linker can't handle you. Hey, you're building a product and a bundle at the same time. The linker's like, I can't link that. At least it can't today. Technically
so what,
speaking, we could make it work. But.
Why don't we force the user to specify which one they want?
As part of the intermediate post link?
Yeah, if you specify output type as intermediate post link, force another switch, like entry or...
We could, but most of the time
it's not necessary.
It doesn't happen that often.
Truthfully, the output type that comes primarily from MS Build, we don't care because it's simply based on the inputs or the intermediates that you provide. So the only extra bit of functionality you get out of that is if you force them to say, I expect I'm building a package and the inputs only include, a bundle entry section. Then we could say, well, you said, now, of course I say that, and the truth is, a lot of this is determined also by the file extension. If, you can absolutely, build a bundle with, the name foo.msi. It's not going to work, but you can do that. But again, as a, reasonable default, we can say, if you're building an MSI or a file with an MSI extension, pretty sure the entry section should be a product.
Technically speaking, we don't prevent today. Do we validate that the output type matches the entry section?
I don't recall that. It might be there, but I don't recall it. I know we do default it. And again, part of this is the output type is something that actually comes from MS Build. It's not a required switch if you're just using Wix.exe. So MS Build has an output type property that we pipe into Wix.exe. Otherwise, I think the default is based on the extension. So we guess an output type based on the output file names, the extension.
Yeah. We don't guess, we know. There's a mapping. There's a
straightforward
mapping, so we determine the output type from the extension type. I'd say it that way.
But I don't think it's enforced. Again, you could do a bundle foo.msi, and it would build.
It would build.
Would work, but it would build.
Not as an exe. Yeah. But an MSI as a PKG file would work, I think. If you had,
PKG?
Foo, right? And you said, I'll put an MSI with dot foo extension.
Sure,
that'll work.
Sure.
As long as you have something that calls the MSI API on the thing that's dot foo. I haven't tried this before.
Right.
I assume it would work. Double clicking on, of course, won't.
Yeah. Oh, I actually I'm almost 100% confident it would work because it turns out if you use the name attribute in your package authoring in a bundle, it's really easy to end up with packages that are named without an extension. There's a Microsoft product whose name I don't remember which one that does this. There's, you know, you end up with an extensionless file in the package cache, and it's an MSI, and it's not just fine.
Yeah. Okay. So I guess we could check the output type and against the entry section. We haven't before, and it's not been a huge problem as far as we know, but would we be helping people?
I just think it would make the code easier if we knew what the target was.
Would you filter out other entry sections that don't match? Or would you still error if you had multiple entry sections?
Well, I mean, we have like a bug open about if we're specifying burn stuff in an MSI, or we're specifying MSI stuff in a burn, like, don't we want to start erroring out when they try to do that? I don't remember what we were trying to do there, but I remember silently.
Yeah, no, there's a couple of cases where we, like, variables and properties get silently ignored, and depending on what you're building, and the searches don't quite work out. The hope was the searches could eventually be done by custom actions, would solve that problem. But it was properties, and I think it's properties and variables that were the biggest problem.
Yeah, they get confusing. Well, and truthfully, you can have custom actions in a bundle. Well, in bundle authoring. They don't actually, you know, do anything. They get thrown out.
Right.
Yeah, I guess I thought we would handle them the same way, whatever way we decide to go with that.
We will always know the output type at link time. Do we always know the output type at link time? I don't remember.
Yes, because we have an entry section at that point.
Sorry, we can determine an output type from the entry section, but do we know what the user asked for?
Oh, no. Yeah.
Yeah, we don't always know at link time. I mean, technically speaking, unless you told the linker.
Huh. Right. Yeah, sorry, that goes back to what Sean said, that we should, you know, force them to do that. Today we don't. Today output type is completely optional on the command line. It's probably not optional in MS build. No, there's an MS build default in wix.targets. But that default always turns into an output type switch on the, you know, pseudo command line.
Right.
So from MS build, we always know what, you know, the user requested. We don't by default from, you know, a naked invocation, because we don't force it, because we can determine it based on entry sections. So my only hesitation there is it is, to me, slightly more interesting to talk about what you would do if you had multiple entry sections. You know, we're really familiar with the idea that, you know, one invocation of MSBuild or one invocation of, you know, light.exe. Well, actually, light.exe is a perfect example, because traditionally it's one output, but with localization it can be multiple. We extend that a little bit into the future. Well, could you, say, have a bundle and the MSIs that it consumes built from one invocation? That doesn't make as much sense in MSBuild, but it starts to make more sense with Wix.exe, because it's just here's a bunch of source files.
Build it all,
link it all. Now, we're still busted on that. There's still a lot of assumptions, you know, about there being a single output. So I don't know if, I don't know how valuable it is. But I've been doing a lot of work in a WiX pipeline extension. And you could imagine that an extension might have more to say on the topic. You know, being able to filter out from all of these, from having multiple entry sections, you know, an extension might want to do more if the overall system allowed it. And today it doesn't, but it's slightly more interesting to me than the alternative, which is to start explicitly enforcing that there be a single output and you're, you know, and you're specifying its type and we're going to check that and, you know, force you to be consistent.
I don't have a strong opinion here. I don't have a strong opinion here. I think we need to improve this error message. That's the one thing that I need. Being more restrictive on having the output type at the entry section match, I'm not as... I guess we could.
Yeah, I kind of don't want to enforce, I don't want to require that the output type be specified. It's going to be specified, well, actually, but it's not specified. So the root of this bug is that it's not specified even when using MS build.
That's true.
Because intermediate post link,
yeah, it doesn't.
We decided is the output type, but it's, in this case, it's more of a hint to the compiler to, you know, link and then stop. Because, you know, an intermediate postlink file still has an entry section with an output, you know, with a matching output type. So in a way, it's IPL is like a minor abuse of the output type concept.
So what does it do today if there is multiple entry sections?
That's a separate error.
Hey, another error said found multiple entry sections. There's going to be one kind of message. It's a Highlander.
That's right. Mm-hmm. And that's perfectly reasonable today because, again, we have these, you know, there's a bunch of assumptions along, you know, in the tool set, in the... extension model that assumes for every invocation there's going to be one output file.
So I guess I would just list all the entry sections that we're looking for.
In the case of intermediate, yeah, I think that's the thing to do for that. You know, all the entry sections that we know about, or even just say, here's an example of them. Because if you're doing intermediate post link, you're one step ahead of the newbie, right? Or a couple steps ahead of the newbie to WiX. So I don't know that it's like, oh, yeah, oops. It's going to be pretty obvious when we tell you, you need to put your product, bundle, module, or something like that. You'd be like, oh, yeah, okay, let me go put that in there. Just right now what it says is you need to go put the expected type of intermediate posting, which, of course, doesn't make any sense because there is no type of that.
Right. That's the primary thing I wanted in this bug report. This is, the message is completely wrong because, again, intermediate post link is not a section type. So I would, you know, volunteer to take this bug along the lines of there should be at least two instances of this message. You know, one for IPL that maybe just lists all the possible entry section types. And the other, perhaps, N messages that are like, if we know what the expected entry section type is, then craft the message to be more explicit. So like if it's not intermediate post link, the output type that, and we know the output type is supposed to be package, then the error message should say could not find the product entry section or could not, whatever the wording is. It, you know, might blow up the number of messages, but I'm okay with that.
Yeah, I'm not, yeah. That is not a problem.
If that makes sense, I'll sign on to do that.
I think we should do that for this error message. I'm also fine if Sean wants to continue to press for these, you know, output type and this should match error kind of message.
Well, mainly I was just wondering how we're going to actually implement that feature where if you try to use a variable in an MSI that it will complain.
Well, because we find the entry section first, we know what kind of things we're looking for, and we can filter that way.
Okay.
So, because the way the linker works is the first thing it does is find a single entry section. If it finds none, you get this error message. If it finds many, you get a different error message, and it stops. Then once it finds the entry section, then it does the work to go, you know, gather the rest of applicable fragments, because you certainly could have in your set of fragments, you know, properties and variables all mixed together. But if you don't bring in a fragment that has the mismatched stuff in it, you know, it should be ignored. In fact, if you bring in a fragment that has an error, and if you don't bring in a fragment that has an error, we ignore it. That's purposeful. That saves you. Well, that's one of the advantages of the linker. So, so it's all based off of at that point the entry section, which is why I'm torn on the output type mismatching the entry section, right? If you say you're building a bundle and the entry section is clearly a package, that is odd, right? And you're not going to get what you want or expect anyway. So,
I'd be fine with adding a message that says, if we know the expected entry section type.
And it could also be a warning, and then it's a warning or an error, right? At that point, you could also say, you know, we don't want to force, I don't know, but what does it mean? Like, the output type then is going to be used to select the binder, right? Because you have to know the output type for the binder.
Yeah, but I'm betting that, we use the entry set. That's, you know, again, we don't force the user to specify the entry section type because we'll use the one that we find, and today if we find not one, it's an error.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd be fine in saying, you know, if we, you know, we should again continue with the, you know, not one is an error. But if we then find one, adding an additional check, and I'm going to say I'm fine with it being an error, saying, you know, look, you told us you wanted to build a package, but you gave us a bundle. One of those things is wrong.
Yeah, I think I'm done with that too. Yeah, I can see that too. Yep.
Okay. I will add that to this bug and do it both of them.
Oh, okay. You're not going to create a separate issue for that? No. No, I'm just...
I don't get paid by issues, so not anymore.
Yeah, right. All right. That took a lot longer than I thought it would, but that's okay. WiX Cop V4 should handle QT exec and WiX CA renames. Yes, this was a little more tricky than expected.
Yes, unfortunately. So back in WiX 3.10 era, I added a set of silent exec custom actions. Quiet exec, QT exec, quiet exec runs a particular process and dumps the output into the log, without much concern for, you know, sensitive information. Silent exec explicitly does not log the output or even the command line, assuming that there's some sensitive information. Unfortunately, silent doesn't quite match the QT abbreviation, so I added them as WiX silent exec and WiX silent exec 64. And then I said, well, having QT exec around bugs me, so I added clones that of the QT exec that are WiX quiet exec and WiX quiet exec 64. And then I said, we're going to deprecate the QT exec, and they won't be supported in WiX 4. The problem is that I then went ahead and broke out. There's a property you can set, QT exec command timeout. I forget the exact name. That in V3 was used for both 32-bit and 64-bit. When I added silent exec and quiet exec, I broke those out so you could have separate timeouts for 32-bit and 64-bit processes. And there's no way for WixCop to automatically convert the old timeout property into the new timeout properties, because there's no way to tell what's 32-bit and what's 64-bit. Everything else, all the renames are there except for that one property. So that work is done. It is as done as it can get. You'll get an error message if you use the timeout property, but I went searching on GitHub and just general binging and Googling, and I couldn't find anyone who's actually using that property. So I decided it was probably rare enough that I wasn't going to be too sad that WixCop couldn't automatically convert it. Otherwise, that work is done. So,
long answer, understood, all good?
I'm fine with it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Null reference when trying to unset a version variable. This is kind of interesting. And I never thought about doing it this way, but yeah, that makes sense that that might not work. The question is, you know, do we fix it in 4.0 or does someone else, does someone want to take it 4.0? I'm like, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know manage BAs. Is equal null the correct way to unset a variable?
Yeah, it's a way of clear. Yeah, sure. I mean, it's kind of the way of clearing it. So yeah, arguably. Version to long. Yeah.
So that's the MBA core.
Yeah, it's all on the managed side. It's like, it's because version is a struct, I think, or it may just be a matter of checking that when null is passed in, going, oh yeah, don't try to assign this to, if the object is null, don't try to do version from it, kind of thing. It probably is that simple, and I haven't looked. So, version to long.
Presumably it's trying to pass null as a version.
Yeah. Presumably. Could be that equals null is the wrong way to do it, but it shouldn't have a null reference exception either, right? I mean,
yeah. Well, like I said, I'm like, that looks a little weird to me, but it's kind of a general thing of like, how do you unset something?
Yeah, I'd have to look. Also, it could also be that, you know, you could do version variables dot remove parentheses, you know, called the remove method. I don't know if the version, because there are special collections, so I don't know if the remove is exposed. excuse me, is exposed on them. Anyway, we take a look at this in 4, or are we just going to let someone take a look at it in 4X if they want?
I'm fine with 4X. I mean, I don't. The only reason to put it in 4.0 is if we think we want to introduce, remove, or if necessary.
Yeah. Yep. Okie dokie.
4X?
Yep. And if someone wants to fix it sooner, they can.
But not in 3?
No, not in 3.
Well, 4X is, all 4Xs are valid in 4.0, right?
Oh.
That's what the X means.
Yes. If someone wants to bring it up, that's all you have to do.
Yeah.
All right. Include should have the WiX 4 namespace. Oh, WiX 3 didn't require it?
No. It works with it, but it doesn't require it. Yeah, that confused me as well. Basically, as far as I can tell, the preprocessor only looks at the local name, and it will... Yeah, so it'll take anything as long as it says include.
Okay.
WiX 4 is a little bit pickier.
A little bit pickier. Huh. Wonder if it should be.
Well, yeah, I see we do have this problem where, you know, include and define, and these things are, oh, and if. If's the big one, right? It's like you can't, I forget how, I want to say that this is something I learned from Derek. Something like, you know, each with an if and an else, each thing inside the if and inside the else must be valid XML.
Correct.
Right. So this is unlike, say the C preprocessor, where, you know, it's all just text and you can do, therefore, some very interesting and often funky things with the preprocessor. But include is interesting in the same way. It's like, you know, yeah, you kind of want to just be able to dump it in, but you also want the included file to be valid XML. Maybe. Maybe you don't. But mostly you do because you want to be able, you know, it's XML. It's supposed to be, you know,
the thing that's interesting is that in the current, in WiX 3, the include is in a namespace. Like, it doesn't have to be in a namespace.
It doesn't have to be, yeah.
It's not in a
namespace. It's actually...
it's defined in the... Is it defined in the WiX namespace? I expect it is.
Yeah, pretty sure. Because it does work.
Okay.
Although it wouldn't have to be
required.
Again, if it's just looking at the local name.
Uh-huh. Exactly. That's the point. You could put any namespace on it today as the primary one. Now, the end result is that the child elements, must be there in the correct namespaces.
Correct. And what happens if you don't have a namespace on the include element is you get something like, you know, invalid custom element component ref, for example. Because if the include element doesn't have a namespace,
the children
even in WiX 4, the children don't get them.
And what does WiX 3 do differently?
It works
at WiX 3?
It just works, yeah.
That's weird. Is it implicitly adding the WiX namespace to the things? That's just weird.
Yeah, I don't know. I didn't get that far. I was just converting a rather large code base from WiX 3 to WiX 4. Most of the files have the WiX 3 namespace on the include element, so WixCop converts them to the WiX 4 namespace. But if there's no namespace, then WixCop does nothing, even for an include element, and you start to get errors when the included files do something in the Wix namespace.
All right, well, I think WixCop should do the right thing with include statements. I agree with the way that this is worded. WiX 4 has an opinion about namespaces, and it should apply them to include files, including include files that are missing it. So I think that's a safe statement. How it worked at WiX 3, all that kind of stuff, is different. But I think WixCop's opinion is include files should have their namespace on them.
Yeah, unless, as you say, we want to relax that.
No, I still think WixCop should add it. Whether we relax it or not is independent. WixCop's opinion still is, you should put your namespace up here. Basically.
Yeah. Yep, I agree.
Because that's its opinion about everything else. And I think it's generally a good one.
And since I opened the bug and said that, I will go ahead and agree with myself as well.
Yep.
Yeah, I did not go looking in this particular case. Because, again, in this code base that I was converting, it by far the include elements had the namespaces. So there were only a couple that did not have it. But I don't know, you know, in the wider world how common that is.
Okay.
Yep. If I were curious, I might go and say, add a WXI file to a voted project.
See what it does. I agree with the sentiment of this and everything else. It's kind of like, all right. Guidance for building ARM MSIs for Windows. Have we had anybody else asking about ARM around? Like, I think this is the first time I've seen this like publicly being asked for ARM support.
Publicly, yeah.
Yeah.
There was someone a year or two ago.
Was there?
Yeah.
Okay.
I thought that we had gone back. Because I remember Sean's. I agree with Sean's memory. And at a certain point, I thought that we were. We made a build system change to build ARM.
We made it possible for you to build ARM from our source, but we didn't actually turn it on for the publicly released.
Okay.
So I remember doing that a long time ago. I don't remember, like when I was still at Microsoft. I don't remember doing it after.
Yeah. Well, because in that era there was no ARM support.
Yeah, and there's no compiler support.
You were in box, and there was onto Windows 10. I'm pretty sure there was no publicly available SDK for it.
Right.
That has now changed. And you can get ARM and ARM64 in the Windows 10 SDK.
Yep.
So we could build it. Now, the problem is the last time it was built was WiX 3.7. So it's entirely possible that there was some bit rot.
Yeah. All right. Well, we could put this at 4X, and if someone wants to step up to do it, they can. Because at this point in time, the only people I've heard asking for this have been Microsoft people, which seem to be the only people who care about ARM. Which is fine, but it's not.
Although one hopes it'll change. I mean, you know, Windows is supporting it now. But I don't have one.
I sure. Like, let me put it this way. I would rather go fix a high DPI issue in CMutil than I would go put ARM inside WiX right now. Because I think high DPI monitors are more relevant than ARM.
Oh, for sure.
Processors are right now.
At least on Windows.
Yeah. So I'm not going to be spending my free time on this. I'll put it that way. But yeah, so if Microsoft people want to step up or however they want to do that, they can.
Well, yeah. The other thing to remember is, and the bug even mentions ARM 32 and ARM 64.
Yep.
We only did ARM 32-bit last time. Yep. ARM 64 brings in a whole bunch of extra complication, certainly around the extensions.
Yeah, no, I expect.
Ooh, and burn. We have the same problem with burn.
And burn. So I expect this is not a trivial amount of work.
Yeah, absolutely.
This happened, but if someone wants to go through and do the work, and we'll do that. If they had some sort of timeline, then maybe we'll accelerate getting Burns' build process put together. But I was going to raise that up in my questions and answers. Anyway, totally not against it, but I'm not going to be personally getting to this in my free time sooner than later.
If someone wants to send me some nice ARM hardware,
that would
maybe
help.
We could talk. I'm willing to accept, you know, hardware in lieu of cash.
I'm not sure I am, but okay. I don't know what I would
you
do
normally,
with hardware.
Oh, you normally have kids at home. So I don't.
So. it's true. All right, anyway. So totally not against this. It would be great if this happened, but the amount of work into it is non-trivial, and someone's going to have to sit down and really focus this thing down to make it happen. So.
Well, and although the hardware comment was a joke, or the hardware bribe comment was a joke, the truth is, testing this also is not going to be trivial. That's the other half.
It's going to turn into, well, the compiler said it worked, and 30 days
right.
It works.
Yeah.
And it's going to be like, and I'm done. To be honest, though, that's the experience I had with when I got ARM Burn working, 32-bit ARM Burn working for the remote debugger team in ancient history. Mm-hmm.
Right?
It was the same thing. I'm like, well, it builds. And the 32-bit version works. And there were some small number of bugs that were specific to ARM that had to go be hunted down. Although I don't know that any of them required a code change. Maybe it
was
required
build,
a code
build process? Build process or like burn? Burn.
I really don't
execution.
Remember now.
Okay.
So long ago.
That's,
I don't
that's
remember
the other thing. I don't know how.
The guy I remember the guy I was working with also left Microsoft, so I mean I could try to call him. He lives around here somewhere. I could call him up and say, "Dude, you remember how this? What was that bug that I was in your office looking at?" Anyway, we became kind of friends after that. It was fun. It was just anyway, on this little board. I mean, it was literally we had a board sitting on someone's desktop, on his desktop, with all these wires coming out of it. It was
right.
You're like, there, that's an ARM machine, and you're like, wow. Don't touch it. You might shock it. I was like, yeah, this is dumb. All right, let's debug this stupid thing.
But that's pretty impressive because that's, you know, Burn right now is just x86 32-bit.
Right.
You know, it's like, so the fact that...
We don't write crazy code. So it just... We don't.
Mostly I'll agree with that.
Anyway, so I just remember having to debug it, get into it, figure it out. And then I think we even found an MSI bug, too, that they had to go fix. And it was just – it was clearly we were first, and we had to go make it all work for everybody. So.
Yep.
Anyway, totally doable thing. It would be great if someone did that. Going to be some work. So. All right. I think we're done, right? That's the list of today?
That was it.
All right. So, Jacob, I don't know if Jacob fell asleep. I know Sean's been talking, so he's not asleep. Anything anybody else wants to talk about? Questions, comments, things they got going on? All right. I think Jacob maybe. Oh, Jacob's gone. Oh, he ran away. It's too bad. You got anything going, Sean? Actually, I was going to ask that differently. How are you doing? What are you up to? I am... Bob is doing work in WiX 4 to making it go because we have somebody that wants WiX 4, and I'm supporting him fixing bugs as we need to, as I was in September was a crazy month for me, and I'm doing some, and anytime we have one of those months, I end up behind on my normal stuff, so I'm cleaning that up like this week, and then I'm going to get back to helping on some WiX 4 things and dropping in and out. Basically, my goal is to start getting more time to spend on WiX 4 to finishing it. How's your life?
I'm pretty busy right now.
Yeah.
I'm about to move.
Oh,
so.
I was wondering if you sold your house yet.
Yeah, it's in the process, so it's going to take up most of my time for the next few weeks.
Not a problem. Not a problem. It's just, so did you have a direction that you wanted to head? Because I know you were looking at a number of different things, you know, from Burn to tools to help things go to, I don't know, you did the WiX cop initially, right? Or I don't remember.
Right. Yeah.
And things like that, which was great because then I could just go in and fix a bug in it. It was great.
I was thinking about actually fixing the test that I wrote, but then you went ahead and did that. So
yeah. Well, Bob said he hit the problem, so I had to fix it in a hurry.
Well, but that was one of those, oh no, that was the bug you found the reason for, as opposed to the bug you accidentally fixed.
I fixed several things by fixing the code. Yeah. Because the code in there, I went in and was like, this is not good enough. And I just fixed the code and everything started working. It's like, yay, the code is now better and it works better. So less complicated code, have fewer bugs. I'm okay with that answer. All right. So
I might do the tool that you were talking about upgrading the NuGet packages.
On the like in the extension and such?
Yeah.
All right. That would be cool. My hope is to get unblocked in the next 2 weeks-ish, and then I'm going to have to sit and decide, do I try to tackle merge modules or do I start bringing over burn? And so I think the next meeting I'll ask that question to the people here, right? All right, so if everything goes as well as I hope it does, I'll ask next in 2 weeks-ish. All right, so I have a couple different paths I can go. What would you guys like to see, right? And supporting Bob always is, you know, the number one thing that I've been doing in that kind of space. So
I mean, I guess approving my burn pull request would be.
Oh, is that the next? Did step. I not do that? Oh. See, I mentally checked that off. That was, it's done. I probably should actually go do that then. Yes. No, don't.
I think what happened was Bob was talking about doing something related, and then you tried to pawn it off on him.
Oh, and then I mentally just signed it and was done. if it was anywhere near September, I totally could see myself just being like, I do not have room for more. So, all right, yes, I will. That'll definitely happen before I move to anything else then. So, all right. Cool. Jacob, did you have anything that you wanted covered since you dropped off and came back? Don't know if your house is sold since Sean is in the process of selling his, or it has sold, or I don't know. You've done all that paperwork and closed it, so you're done with that part?
I just passed the deadline where they could get out for any reason, so.
Well, they can always get out. Just they get to give you free money then. So.
Yeah.
People tend not to want to do that, so that's good. Although, don't you have to do the walkthrough or whatever? Isn't there a way out of that? Or you're past that deadline, too?
I'm past all the deadlines to where they can get out of it.
All right. All right, cool. Jacob seems to be quiet. Oh, yeah, I think he's having connective issues. So, on that note, I think we're in a decent spot. We'll be back in 2 weeks, which is looks like it's the 1st of November, so it'll be just after Halloween, so everybody can come in all kinds of punchy, hyped up on their candy.
I think you're off by a week.
Am I off by a week? Oh, 25th instead of the 1st.
Yep.
All right, cool. That works out even better. So we have to have a conversation before Halloween. All right, cool. Sounds good to me. All right, 2 weeks, we'll be back here. We'll do it all again, hopefully fewer issues, and we'll talk more about what we're doing in WiX 4. Until then, see you later. Bye.
Bye.